take them.
Hello, everybody.
Assalamu alaikum. Peace be upon you and welcome to Salam Cafe. It's the end of the school holidays and my wife and I are wrapped. Love the kids and everything, but on behalf of, I think, all parents in Victoria, very pleased to see the kids back at school. Yourself, Ahmed, you were saying that you actually went away for your holidays?
Yeah, we took a couple of days off and went down to the Great Ocean Road, stayed on a little farm down there, showed the kids where milk comes from and eggs. They went every morning and collected breakfast.
That's the supermarket, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, no, they went and collected eggs for us from the, you know, from under the chickens. And actually, the farm had this experiment. We had two ducklings raised by a chook and stuff like that. And we went to the Great Apostles, or as I like to call them, Al-Hawariyun.
You're going to have to explain that.
Yeah, Al-Hawariyun is the word in the Quran which describes the apostles of Jesus, because we believe in Jesus as a prophet, and his apostles are called Al-Hawariyun in the Quran. So I was showing the kids, I said, oh, these are the 12 Hawariyun. And I don't think they knew what I was talking about.
Is that the first time anyone's called them that?
I think maybe.
But it's not the first time anyone's seen... I should say Muslims see Jesus or Isa alayhi salam, as we call him, as one of the prophets of God. We believe that he existed and he's a very important figure. We mention him by name in the Quran as well.
Yeah, my daughter's name is Maryam, which is Mary, mother of Jesus, and we believe in the virgin birth. So
actually, there's a mosque in Werribee called Mary, Mother of Jesus Mosque.
Yeah, exactly.
Wow. They did it. It's next to a church. I thought that's a good way to actually build some good relations.
Some harmony in the community.
Did your kids actually knock down that apostle, the one that wrote?
Yeah, it was such a shame. It was like the pile of rubble now. It used to be so
beautiful.
How many
are left, I mean?
Yeah, there are definitely not 12.
There's only about 8 left.
Okay, we need to go to a very exciting Salam Cafe again.
You're just saying that because you're in it.
And you're in it too, mate. Let's go have a look.
These guys are wrapped.
Tell me, have you ever heard the term the MCG is the Mecca of Australian football?
Yes, I've heard it and we live it. Down the street with the people way down low.
Ain't no sound but the sound of speech. Machine guns ready to go. Why do you think they call the MCG the Mecca of football?
I think it's the biggest games are played here, and it's footy's been played here the longest time.
So you're on your pilgrimage to the Mecca of footy?
Absolutely.
Do you have any idea why we'd call it the Mecca of footy as opposed to like the Coliseum or something else?
Hey, Paul!
No, I can't say I do.
Do you know where Mecca is?
No.
Yeah, I do.
Yeah, fair. Well, I guess you're here anyway.
Absolutely.
You're in Mecca.
Absolutely.
Alright, the MCG is known as the Mecca of Australian rules football. Why do you think it's known as the Mecca of the game?
Oh, it's sort of the tradition down here and the amount of people you can get in, and it's sort of the home of footy and everyone wants to play here.
Do you know where Mecca is?
Mecca, yeah. In Greece, isn't it?
Hey, can I just ask you real quick? Do you guys do henna?
Henna, no.
Huh?
It's like it feels like you've had like a religious experience, like you're so moved.
Oh, mate, that's what I said. I do feel moved. It's unbelievable. I feel like I'm floating. Like, it's indescribable.
Be fair to say that you take this under pretty seriously.
Yeah, mate. Yeah.
Alright, we're here with a West Coast fan and a Sydney fan. So can we just see you guys just tough it out now, just before the match?
We're in the ground seeking gates 4, 5 or 6. If you're seeking gate 4, 5 or 6,
I'm thinking of lobbying the AFL to get them to release some AFL endorsed headscarves for me to wear in footy colours. Do you think that'd be a good idea?
I think it'd be a fantastic idea.
Oh, I think so. I can't see no difference with it. You look very nice what you're wearing now, and even if you had Eagles colours on, you'd even look better.
Oh, shucks!
Why not? If they're blue and gold, who cares?
I'm queuing to see if I might be able to buy some Islamic footy merchandise.
Yeah. Would you be on the organising committee for, say, designing these hijabs?
Absolutely. I've got a marketing degree. I'll be in that for sure.
I was just wondering, do you sell any, like, team headscarves that I could wear?
No team headscarves.
Why not?
They're really not popular. We had them earlier on in the season, but they just weren't selling, so...
I guess I should have come earlier. See, I told you I was an MCC member. However, I do think this may be the first time a hijabi has had a broadcast crew Channel 10 network pass ever. So another first for the hijabs.
Guys, we've got to go pre, man. It's time. There's a pre room at the MCG. Let's go, stand here. Do you know where the prayer room is?
The
prayer room?
Yeah, it's straight down that way. Turn right. I'll take you guys.
Oh, personalised.
Okay, we're going to go into the prayer room now. You going to make wudu?
We're going to make wudu.
Go back to work, mate.
Salaam alaikum. Salaam alaikum.
You too.
Salaam
alaikum. We're here actually in the prayer facilities at the MCG, and we're grateful to the MCG and the AFL for giving us this facility.
Like a very religious event, this AFL Grand Final. I'm not too sure who these boys are, they look pretty serious.
Looks like what I prayed in the morning.
That is the West Coast Eagles' call to prayer.
So how do you know Salam Cafe?
I've seen it on Channel 31.
Tell the truth, am I your favourite panel member?
Of course.
Without a doubt.
You consider yourself religious then, I'd say? What are you religious?
I'll believe in anything at the moment.
Salam Cafe!
Salam Cafe!
Salam Cafe! Salam Cafe! Wow. Now, I don't know much about footy, but, you know, you guys have just won me over. That looked like a great day there. And, you know, talking to the real players.
In the dressing rooms, I noticed.
How did you guys get in there?
Well, you know, we're media now. We sort of wandered in. I mean, it's where we belong.
That was sensational. We actually even got to sing the team song with the players. And I had Ahmed on my shoulders.
In the traditional way.
Oh, it wasn't that heavy. He's been watching his diet, especially with Ramadan coming up, practicing.
It was unbelievable. Waleed and I were just pinching ourselves. It just as a football fan, if it was Carlton, it just would have been incredible. It's going to be a long time until that happens. I know. Same performer. My Richmond support is going to be this long time. But getting the access, going in, seeing, actually being in that dressing room was incredible. Talking to the players. And I've seen the game again, and now it's like you know the people.
And just the vibe as well, the community, of a win. And
the community spirit, you could say, even before the game started, everyone was already pumped up and ready to go, sharing something in common.
Yeah, but it was amazing because Susan, in particular, she was asking a lot of people about whether or not they reckon it'd be a good idea to get, like, hijabs in AFL colours. Now, that's a pretty sort of out there question to ask just people you don't know. But what was amazing about the day was nobody cared. Like, it was just... Yeah, anything, as long as it's in my team's colours. Mm. Yeah. It was quite amazing the way that it just spans everyone. Mm.
Really. Tell you what, though, I'd say since you guys have had a go, I think Toltu and I should do some, make use of the media tags and visit some events. What do you say?
Where do you want to go?
As long as it's not the grand final, I'm going for it.
Australian Open.
Oh, probably, yeah.
I think maybe we should think about some fashion week. I think they have it in Melbourne.
That's certainly right.
We could do
that.
That
would be a good one. Go down and get the Muslim perspective.
Keep everyone tuned.
No, it's good to make use of that prayer room. That was, I think, the first time they've had, you know, Muslims praying in congregation. I mean, we made good use of that.
And I've got to say a big thank you to the AFL and to Channel 10 for giving us access, because they certainly didn't have to do that.
No, correct.
And, hardly like we're a rival network to Channel 10 in the grand final, but they didn't have to do that. Mm. So thanks very much. I really appreciate it.
And even saw like all the Swans players and officials, they were magnificent. Mm. They were just opened up to us. We got the opportunity to talk to those guys, took pictures for the kids, got a couple of autographs, mm. and it was magnificent.
Well, even when you did the West Coast changes, but I don't think it would have been appropriate to...
No, it was very...
Don't be rubbing it in their faces, guys.
Very solid. No, we need to wrap it up. Let's move on from the footy. We've got a great youth award that we actually promoted at the start of the year called the YAMY. We're going to meet the winner after the break. So we'll have both the coordinator and the winner after the break, and we'll find out who it is from this Australia-wide contest. We'll be back in a moment. This evening on Salam Cafe we have two guests. So one is a repeat guest from our first episode of this season, Miss Monique Tui, the coordinator of the MCCA Young Australian Muslim of the Year Awards, and the eventual winner, Miss Qamar Atosh from East Preston Islamic College. Before we go to Qamar and congratulate her.
Thank you.
Let's hear from Monique and remind us about what the Young Australian Muslim of the Year Awards is all about.
Bit of a mouthful, isn't it?
Definitely.
I've been saying it all year. The Young Australian Muslim of the Year Award is has been a nationwide search for inspiring role models, Muslim role models who have made significant contributions to the community that they work for, the Muslim community and the wider Australian community. We've been looking for people who actively acknowledge their Australian Muslim identity, who have been involved in volunteer work and raising money for causes, and you know, people who have been involved in extracurricular activities in school and outside of school.
Well, the award night was fantastic. I was there, and not least with the host, MC on the night, Nazim. And tell us about some of Qamar's contenders from interstate.
Well, this year there were 38 nominations, which was pretty good for our first year, we thought, from four different states. And we had some really interesting nominations. One of my favourites is a Year 12 boy who delayed his VCE studies at the beginning of this year to take his grandmother to Hajj in Mecca, okay. And that was really nice. Yeah. And sort of put him off, and then had to come back and catch up on his Year 12 studies and that type of thing. That was a really nice one. We had other interesting nominations that were filled out by people who were well intentioned, saying she's a lovely girl and she's very very kind and she dresses really nicely and
she makes good curry.
Yeah. Not quite, but unfortunately didn't fit all the criteria, but Qamar's nomination definitely stood out from the rest.
So you said four states, which four?
The states were Melbourne, Sydney, that's Adelaide and Perth.
Those are cities.
Oh, yes. Victoria, New South Wales.
So what about the territories?
Next year.
The territories.
Where is that?
Unfortunately, we didn't have any nominations from there, but I guess that's... Yeah, with something next year to be much
Qamar,
bigger.
I understand, won the Darabin Youth Summit Leadership Award.
Yes, I did.
Now, what was that for?
Yeah, that was for a group of us girls from East Preston Islamic participated in a leadership program. And most of us went to this congress and forums for a few weeks. And at the end of this, we actually received awards. And at the end, there's going to be... a centre built in Northlands because of our contribution to this event.
Wow,
yes.
Fantastic.
And what will that centre be for?
It's going to be for youth. It's like a drop-in centre where they can come and if they have any issues and stuff like bullying and anything to do with the youth, they can come there and approach the people there. We'll probably be too old when it's open, but other youth people can come.
How old are you again?
17.
And you started a drop-in.
And for 17-year-old, I've just been looking at all your achievements, Qamar, and it's amazing, very long list. I'm interested in this basketball tournament that you helped out with. What was that about?
Oh, actually participated in.
Okay.
It was actually a youth African program that was organized by one of the ladies from the African youth program, and all of us participated in it, most girls from East Preston Islamic College, because the majority there is Somalian girls. So what happens is, at the end of each term, all of them sign up to participate in a program in a basketball tournament, and they verse each other from other different states and stuff. So yeah, I participated in that because I thought it was a great opportunity for me to have fun and make new friends.
I saw something, even though it's a rival law firm, I saw something about a social justice essay you wrote for a firm or in a competition sponsored by Deakin.
Deakin, that's
yes, that's true. I wrote an essay about homelessness And I had to, there was actually a few criteria you had to meet. You had to explain why you think homelessness is a bad thing and what you can actually do as an individual to overcome that. And I wrote a few points that I can't actually remember because it was a long time ago.
Just one of many things.
Yeah.
Seven, this is, you're 17. When I was 17, I was walking into trees, basically. That's about the extent of my
life. Playing Mario.
That's about
right. It's funny you mentioned trees because there were quite a lot of nominations, and on the nomination forms it had that, you know, that they were, that young people are out there planting trees and raising money for
and
different causes.
Well, on the night you had a year seven boy, he said he watched the film Ryan's Well, and he was so inspired that he went fundraising to build a well in a foreign country.
His speech, when he came up and gave a little talk, he made all the girls in the crowd cry, and the boys
the audience
covering their faces.
The boys were crying.
Yeah, I know. But, you know, I just tried to hide it.
And you must have had so much fun reading all these nominations and all the things that these young people out there have done and contributed to.
Yeah, I was absolutely in a privileged role to read about the inspiring work that young Muslims are doing across Australia. It's just amazing. And one of the goals of this project is to recognise the contribution that young people are making to the Australian community and to celebrate that. And that's what the awards ceremony was about.
Mm. Speaking of which, show us your award. Come on, let's have a look.
I'll hold it up for young Qamar here. It's a very distinguishable award there. It's got the little YAMY guy on. I'm not too sure if you can see him because of the... the glass, or should I say, it's probably real diamonds, you know. He's become a bit of a star around East Western Islamic College since winning this event.
You also won a laptop.
Oh, I was already a star, though.
Oh, I just put your award down there. And now you're on TV. And,
It's my first time on TV, actually. I'm a bit nervous.
Yep.
I can't see
that. Channel 31, that's where it all happens, all right?
Yeah. So along with this award, you also won a laptop computer. Now, that was, did you realise that was actually Monique's old laptop? That she just...
Actually, I went to Monique's house to visit her husband the other day, and I found a brand new laptop on the kitchen table.
We were just testing it out. Seeing it work.
No, it's still good, though, even though it's old. It still works good.
And so what about the future? You've got this award. I mean, what happens now? You walk around in a tiara?
That's pretty funny, yeah. Last time, after the award ceremony, a few people approached me like to do an interview and stuff, and I actually thought they were joking. The guy asked, what's your next thing? Is it a Nobel Peace Prize or something? And I just said no. But my next... I don't have any plans after this. I just when I finish my VC, I just want to go to Malaysia. And I've applied there because I want to go to the International Islamic University of Malaysia.
Okay.
And that's my next thing, inshallah. And I want to become a forensic pathologist.
Wow. Well, so do they teach forensic pathology at the Islamic University?
They do medical science and then you can specialise there.
I think she's going to introduce it. You're going to go over and say, I'm here, let's start this course.
Why not? She's done everything else.
Exactly.
Before she goes to Malaysia, we hope that Qamar will be actively involved in a whole range of YAMY Youth Council type activities and going around and inspiring young people.
You actually had a YAMY team, if I've understood.
We did, yes.
And they were out there. Tell us a little bit about that.
That's right. Well, this has been sort of a year-long project, and we've had two conferences, one in Melbourne and one in Sydney, called Aspire to Inspire, and they were motivational youth conferences where we had young role models up there talking about what it's like to be a Muslim in Australia, how they overcome their challenges, if they see them as challenges, how they try and aspire to achieve success, you know, talking about some of their significant contributions to the community, why they're involved, why they participate in camps or for, you know, non-profit organisations or, you know, that type of thing.
Yeah.
So.
And actually, one of the girls from the Sydney conference actually came down to Melbourne for the awards night with her whole family.
Well, she must have been, you know, quite inspired and wrangled in some of the other boys from her class as well, from one of the Islamic schools in Sydney. And they caught the train and come all the way down for the award ceremony on Friday. And we were absolutely thrilled to see them. It's sort of almost the YAMY is like a family. Not only the young adults who are participating to put on the events, but also, you know, young people are flocking to us at the end of the event
Monique's
saying,
"She's a mother."
I think we didn't see that girl at the footy the next day.
Yeah,
watching the swans. Were they there? Yeah, or,
I don't know what you're talking about.
I want to say, Monique, we must add that it's not just for people who actually attend an Islamic college. It's open for
That's right.
all young Muslims, and whether you go to a state school or non Islamic school, definitely open to you.
I think just, everyone should just keep their eyes and ears open for when the nominations open next year.
That's right.
For,
So we're going ahead next year?
Yeah, it's been supported for 2006, so beautiful. We're looking for many, many nominations from all of the states, even Tasmania.
I want a winner from the Northern Territory.
That would be
fantastic. And are we all too old, Monique?
You guys are too old. Not too old to be on the YAMY team.
You should say we are all too old because Monique falls into that category.
It's for year 10 to 12 students.
That's right. Yeah, the conferences and the award are predominantly aimed at year 10 to year 12 students, but we encourage other people to attend and support our events.
Sensational. On behalf of Salam Cafe, congratulations, Qamar. Great. We look forward to 2006 on great things moving forward. We'll be back after that. Welcome back to Salam Cafe. It's always good to see youth on this program. Makes me feel a little bit young, which is nice for a change. Continuing on with our youth theme, Ahmed's actually got some information for us.
Just an interesting meeting that happened recently. It was the ACIES meeting, which is the Australian Council of Islamic Education in Schools, which is basically the principals of many of the Islamic schools from all over Australia, Perth and Sydney included, as well as Melbourne. And they had a special meeting this time in light of all the debate on values taught in schools. And Peter Kremens, who's the CEO of the Association of Christian Schools, which represents 150 Christian schools in Victoria, as well as many principals of some of the large Jewish colleges and many of the Christian colleges here in Melbourne, attended, as did a professor from the Department of Religious Studies at Monash, and they drafted a declaration of faith-based schools. And some of the points in the declaration are these: we are a proud part of the Australian educational system, committed to teaching according to the government curriculum and shared Australian values. We teach our children about the rights of their neighbours, respect, care and protection of property. We teach the children in our schools to respect the rights of others and understand the different backgrounds and religions of Australia's multicultural society, and so on. So they've got 12 points where all those Christian, Jewish and Muslim schools got together and came up with their shared value statement. So it was a really productive meeting and very important one at this time. And
I think it's really good because it filters down through the principals into the culture of the school, and it reflects on the people, you know, in the community, which is where the children will end up growing up.
Definitely.
And being
mm-hmm. Fantastic. Very good. That's well done, Ahmed. That's great news. Give us some news, Waleed, about the update. I want to know about the winner of this question.
It's been a big one, isn't it? It's just huge. Well, this I think is a Salam Cafe first. We've actually got a back-to-back winner.
Here we go.
Someone who's done a repeat. And that, I guess that means next time they'll be going for a three-peat.
Mm. And going for the hat trick.
That's right. But it goes to Sima Kuruk.
Said the name nicely.
Evet. And the photo is this
one. What
was
the question?
Well, as you'll remember, it was send us your funniest baby photo. Okay. Or really just send us a baby photo. I mean, we just want to look at photos, basically. It was in honour of Assad, who we keep showing really bad photos.
I think he's just...
I know, it's a shame.
I like the thumb-sucking look, and I do believe she's kicked on since then and has actually become the school captain for King Khalid Islamic
that's
College.
Right.
So that's pretty well. So that's the winner.
Yeah. So, yeah, and she writes that she thinks this is hilarious because she actually had to ask her mother first what she was doing, and her mother assured her that she's not picking her nose, she's actually sucking her nose. Personally, I actually think I think this little photo that you see now, I think that really should have been the winner.
Oh, really?
That's a great photo.
I wonder
photo,
who her parents are, Waleed. Mm. Do you know?
Well, you know, whoever they are, they must be pretty special people, I think.
They have great hair.
Actually, where is the Susan tonight? She's not with us?
She's officially on thesis leave.
And she's actually doing it, is she?
Yeah, well, I don't know. I'm not there to supervise. But she's officially, for the next couple of weeks, she's bunkering down and getting her thesis.
Get it finished before Ramadan, because Ramadan starts this week. So our next question's in honour of that.
That's exactly right. So we're going from photos and all those sorts of things. Ramadan, month of fasting. All the Muslims will be gearing up to go dawn to dusk without food, without drink, etc. And that means that when sunset comes, there's an almighty rush to the pantry to get some food. Mm-hmm. So that raises an interesting thing, because sometimes it comes and it's not a real convenient time. You might be at work, you might be
Nowhere near a pantry.
At the grand final, you could be anywhere. And so what we want to know is, what is the most inconvenient place you've ever been in when the time to break your fast has happened? And so the most inconvenient place you've ever broken your fast. And I reckon it could just about be some ripples.
I think there would be a multitude out there. I can think of playing football as a young kid, doing football training and that kind of scenario. So it's always hard to get a drink, but...
It's very frustrating.
Very frustrating. Great question. Look forward to the start of Ramadan this week, and happy Ramadan, and good fasting
Ramadan
for everybody. And we'll see you all next week, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum, good night, and goodbye.
This is the ultimate, you know, to play in a grand final, winning grand final, and yeah, it's unbelievable.
Oh, it's sort of been a long time, and it's sort of what everyone plays for, and it's been good that I've sort of got one now.
Yeah, it's hard to describe. I just feel like I'm floating. It's like the whole week's been a dream.
Is that your little boy over there behind the fence?
Yeah, that's my little boy. I love him to death.
Last one, how's it feel?
Unbelievable. There it is here. Get a close up of that.